statements do we make about ourselves through our clothing, our art, and our bodies? What about the material belongings we keep around us? All of these things are, in their own way, a visual language with which we use to express ourselves and to help form our identity. Who we are and what we intend to say isn't limited to just these things, but certain subcultures rely heavily on these forms to solidify a presence in such groups. It's these subcultures which have found their way into gaming, and games like Jet Set Radio and Splatoon have embraced them fully to form their own identities. The developers of both games made it a point to heavily reference youth culture, particularly that of Tokyo, Japan in the 90s. Splatoon's Inkopolis Plaza is inspired by Shibuya, and Jet Set Radio City is even called Tokyoto, as well as possessing clear visual similarities to its real-life counterpart. Shibuya is regarded as the street-style hub of Tokyo, packed with trendy clothing stores and fashionable people. Similarly, Splatoon has a great emphasis on visual customization of your character, with clothing and accessories replicating the kinds of things you'd find in Shibuya. It's this possibility of self-expression through something that can be easily changed that makes fashion feel like a form of freedom. It's the ability to communicate a part, or perhaps even your whole self, without having to make any permanent commitments. The options available to you include sporty, punk, hip-hop, and skater wear, to mention a few. There's even the inclusion of in-game brands, mimicking the very real infatuation with brands in youth culture today. For example, this hat has what appears to be a Supreme-inspired logo on it, a brand which has people lining up for hours for a chance to pick up something from an exclusive release. Supreme is infamous for its connection to the hypebeast style, and could be argued to be part of the clothing collector scene. This is an indication that clothing is no longer something to just cover your body with, but it's a way of presenting an impression of yourself, and in a lot of cases, a way of displaying your wealth. Cosmetic features aren't unique to Splatoon, as many other games adopt this usually in the form of unlockables or microtransactions. Normally, the coolest clothing or armor is hard to get or requires real-life money to purchase. And regardless of whether it actually looks good, it still proves something to other players who see you, that you're either a skilled player or you have the money for it, whether that's in-game or real life. Luckily, Splatoon just requires you to play a fair amount of the game to get the clothing you want, meaning it's more accessible for people to experiment with, and you don't have to ask your parents for their credit card. In the game, you don't need to submit to one style, however, as you can mix and match to your heart's desire, and is what drives fashion forward. Wanna pair some Jordans with a gas mask and a fishing vest? Go ahead, there are no rules. Splatoon's clothing and accessories do have stat boosts, although I, along with many others, prioritise the aesthetic aspect over the function. I'd play Salmon Run just for the unique items it rewarded you with, and would check the in-game stores daily for anything new. Sneaker culture is probably my favourite influence on the customization, and I'll change my character's footwear often, partly because I don't feel like splashing the cash on Yeezys in real life. The game's world is a version of our own where you're able to navigate trends without the commitment. I would be excited to see the new headgear, tops, and footwear every day and make sure I purchase as much as I could, so my virtual closet would be full of things that I could test putting outfits together with. Splatoon has further embraced their influences, and have released an art book in the form of a magazine you can see in-game, called Hikara Walker. It really goes to show how the essence of the game's identity is its approach to fashion and style. While lacking customization, Jet Set Radio features characters with a familiar style too. Its inspirations are based on the 90s styles seen around Harajuku, whereas Splatoon includes more modern styles too, although you'll find both can be very similar in terms of its skater wear attire. Splatoon's developers wanted to have skater fashion present as they saw it fit to bring in and integrate with the gameplay. The developers were around 30 years old at the time, and a lot of the fashion in the game is inspired by the style they grew up with during their teenage years. Hisashi Nagami, the producer of Splatoon, said that it's very 1990s. The team grew up with a great adoration for that style, and they reflected that in the game. He thinks that it really resonates with people who grew up with the same influences. Of course, this kind of urban style actually originates from America. The music, the dance, the graffiti, and the clothing style expanded their reach, and in turn became a lot more consumerist, yet still retained the self-expression that makes it fun. Fashion itself is a very temporary thing. What was in style last month might not be now, so while this has its benefits for freedom of self-expression, urban subcultures have turned to a more permanent form of this. Right there! upon starting up Jet Set Radio, you're met with this message stating that graffiti is art. However, it's also an act of crime, and Sega does not condone the real-life act of vandalism, blah blah blah. Of course, the actual content of the game contradicts the warning, and the rebellious quality of graffiti is essentially idolized and in tangent with the subculture it explores. Oftentimes, graffiti is intrinsic to the identity of a city. It's what makes it feel urban and owned by its people, in a sense, and highlights the presence of these subcultures. In 1982, the mayor of New York launched an anti-graffiti ad campaign which used the slogan, "Make your mark in society, not on society." But that was the whole point. The buildings and public transport that became synonymous with society's daily lives weren't technically owned by society, the everyday people. It's owned by the government, the minority who probably don't even use trains. These artists were making a statement about society, on society, to be heard by society. Messages found in graffiti are often political, or sometimes it's just tagging, which is the act of marking your street name. Although we have to remember that the act of graffiti itself is anti-establishment by nature, regardless of what the subject matter is. A wall is a blank space, a canvas for these artists, and although the artistic value of graffiti is often debated, it's the urge to let others know that you are here and that you exist. It's a more permanent form of marking your identity than fashion is, for example. As long as it isn't removed or painted over, you're leaving a trace of yourself for other people to see, and you're practically guaranteeing someone will see it since it's in a public space. Not to mention the possibility of fame. I mean, who could forget Banksy? Even a famous artist called Eric Haze was directly involved in Jet Set Radio's graffiti designs. Tagging is something that both Jet Set Radio and Splatoon feature in their core gameplay, with the aim of the majority of Jet Set Radio's levels to spray your mark in certain places around the map. In Splatoon, you'll find plenty of graffiti and sticker bombing within the world, and while not as visually refined, the Turf War mode is all about trying to cover as much of the map with your team's ink as possible and battling the opposing team as you do. It's territory through art. It's rebellious, but not violent. In fact, it's the establishment that's presented as aggressive. Both games use the act of graffiti to establish your presence in a certain group, and that by being in a group, you get to express your own individuality, in this case your appearance, while still feeling a sense of belonging. Besides, graffiti doesn't have to be a lonesome project. Oftentimes, multiple people will work on one piece, so as to get it done quickly without getting caught. Splatoon also has online display messages, where you can draw or write anything you want within a specific space. Whatever you create will be displayed next to your character in the plaza for others to see, and whether you intend it to or not, it represents you in a way. It's just an extension of the self-expression Splatoon provides the player via appearance. In the same way, Jet Set Radio has a graffiti editor, where players would spend a lot of time browsing the web for appropriate JPEGs, or even making their own to individualize their in-game graffiti. Graffiti isn't just a part of the gameplay. In Jet Set Radio, it also has an influence on its art style. The cel-shaded visuals have not only provided the game with a timeless feel, but have given it a unique aesthetic that have, for a lot of people, formed the majority of its identity. While Splatoon also has cartoon influences, it pairs itself with a sea life aesthetic that again has resulted in an incredibly unique identity that is immediately recognizable. It would be criminal of me to not mention music in this video, so let's start by talking about Japanese hip-hop. Although rather informal and small scale, the early days of Japanese hip-hop provide the history for the emergence of the cultural movement. Early hip-hop was not led by corporate interests, but rather was largely ignored by large record companies and performance venues. In this respect, Japanese hip-hop offers a representation of cultural globalization, as it expanded despite criticism on the part of record companies and major media outlets. The history shows that certain kinds of cultural exchange are not initiated through cultural understanding, but instead from some interaction that can incite a desire to learn, to participate, and to contribute individuality. In Japan, this motivation to represent individuality was breakdancing, which was one of the leading edges of hip-hop at the time. In Jet Set Radio, breakdancing is something that all the characters seem to do instead of standing idle. It adds a lot more personality and reflects its importance in urban subculture. The music in Jet Set Radio in particular features a lot of sampling, and in the same way, the fashion is a melting pot of styles and inspirations too. There are DJs present in both Jet Set Radio and Splatoon, giving an actual origin or purpose for music playing over your gameplay. They also provide story information or updates, and have cemented themselves as characters representative of the franchise. Splatoon has even had real-life concerts which have taken place. Hisashi Nagami said that in terms of the sound, we were trying to create music that would be trendy for the Inkling youngsters in the game. That's the image we had for the music that plays during the battles. It's like there's a band inside that world, and they're creating hits for the youngsters. Initially, there were 5 songs that played during battle, but 2 months later, there's a new trend, so we had to add more in the update. It's interesting that Nagami himself mentions trends and having to react to them by adding more in-game content. The same can be said for fashion, which is defined by the most popular or recent style. Things go out of fashion and often come back in. So while Jet Set Radio is a more static view of a particular time, Splatoon tries to keep evolving through additional content. Jet Set Radio, on the other hand, was intentionally the opposite of this. In an interview, director Masayoshi Kikuchi and artist Ryuta Ueda say that while they were trying to put in as much street culture as they could from the start of the project, their aim wasn't to simply chase after whatever cheap new thing was in at the time. That, and it's not a game world based on the concept of real life, Kikuchi added. The visuals are set in what we called the manga dimension, a very comic-like 3D world. On the contrary, Splatoon's Hisashi Nagami states that they really wanted the look and feel of the game to match the gameplay. You can have a Mushroom Kingdom to paint, or you can have a real world. They thought that players would be more motivated to paint when they're playing in a more realistic landscape. So, for the hub, we created a city that seems real. And from a visual standpoint, the dull, realistic city palette makes the vibrant colours of the ink pop, which is a lot more satisfying. The things that youth culture used to define themselves also define Jet Set Radio and Splatoon. They ooze coolness, and their strong identities have greatly contributed to their success. It's always these kinds of games that I'm drawn to. Games so unique to themselves and faithful to what they explore. They're not scared to stand out from the crowd and be different. Identity is so damn important.